function and pleasure as a metaphor drawn to help and heal human beings.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Live broadcast of Star Wars from the back of the tank. This is the Resistance edition. We will be covering the recent episode. Does everything sound good to you, Dave? I feel like I'm having some audio problems over here.
Sounds okay on my end.
All right. This is why I quit doing live shows for a while. I was like, I needed a break from all the stress. But we are live, RM channel 001 on TuneIn. If you don't want to have to listen to the website, you can head over to tunein.com, take the show on the go. Anywhere you go, search RM channel 001, and that's where you can get our live channel. Also, if you're a Facebook premium Patreon subscriber, we are broadcasting live in the secret Facebook page as well. Yeah. You can gain that for a meager $15 a month. Live video, Dave. How do you like that?
Oh, it's an easy sell. It's a really easy sell.
Is it an easy sell?
I mean, come on. You get to actually look at us live.
Wow. All right. Also, people can text short code keyword RMD69 to 50597 to receive push notifications whenever a live show is about to start, whether it be Back to Tank, Star Trek, or Supernatural. Text RMD69 to 50597 and get those push notifications.
And you never know, we're going to be busy for the next couple months, so there might be a lot of live recordings.
Yeah. I think that's the fun part about it, is people don't know when we're live. Remember back in the day, you'd have those live DJ appearances, and they'd be like rumors and whispers. So-and-so is going to be at the corner of 4th Avenue and 7th Street at 5 p.m. with tickets! That's kind of what we do. It's like, hey, we're live.
Oh, shit! Something big just happened.
Yeah. All right. At least something big is in my life. All right, so let's get into this, Dave. Star Wars Resistance, Season 2, Episode 2, A Quick Salvage Run, The Synapsis. With the Colossus in need of hyperfuel, Cass suggests they take it from a downed First Order ship. The salvage mission is quickly compromised when the First Order shows up. Dave, give me your initial thoughts on this episode.
Initial thoughts on this episode. It was a well-done episode, but I did have questions about creative decisions. Creative decisions, but that's just normal. Overall, the episode to me was well paced.
Yeah.
It was well done.
Right.
It introduced some questionable things, but I'm willing to actually see where they're going to go with it. Just because, you know, like
when you say questionable, you, like the because this is how I think you and I feel the same way, because the writing, the script was great.
Yeah,
I think the immediate story of the episode was fine. But when it comes to the creative side, there's some decisions that I'm not quite sure.
Yeah.
I'm fully on board. Now, we're only the second episode in to the new season, and that could, I mean, I think we're going to be like this. You know, we're going to be back and forth, and I think that's probably what they're trying to do, and I'm assuming you're talking about Tam.
Yes.
Yes. So we'll get into that. She's definitely a big part of this week's discussion. This episode was directed by Bosco Ning and written by Brandon Aumann. Now, this is a writer, Dave, that you and I have not been completely on board with. His writing has probably been some of the weakest of all of season one. He did put together a pretty good episode towards the end of last season, but we haven't been the most lovable fans when it comes to his particular scripts.
Yeah.
However, this might be some of his best work. This story was just neat.
Yeah, this was technically well done.
It was tidy.
It was tidy.
And it was a focused story. It was better than the last episode, even though I enjoyed the season premiere. I felt like this was a much stronger installment. We're definitely see where we're going in this episode. We kind of understand the groundwork, the playing field, or I should say the sandbox that we're going to be in this year. There was so much focus in this script, and that's what I was really amazed at how well written this episode was. Brandon Allman might have written his best episode to date. It was focused. It wasn't erratic like some of his previous work. There was a definitive story that was being told here, and it was part of the bigger story, Dave, of not just Resistance, but Star Wars as a whole.
Yeah.
And that's what was really exciting.
And I think pairing him with Bosco was a really great idea, because Bosco is actually a really good directing partner,
right,
for a writer, especially since Bosco has been...
He's been part of this crew since Clone Wars.
Yeah, since Clone Wars. And when you have someone, when a writer is able to actually work off of a director and vice versa, the director is able to work off of a writer, and one of them is a veteran like Bosco is, you can expect the episode to be well done, adequately done.
Yeah, it was good.
Because Bosco understands like what you have to tell. What is the story that you're going to tell for a Star Wars story? Not just any story. The importance of Bosco is the fact that he knows where Star Wars has to go. Because
right.
He's done multiple episodes.
And I think that was the big highlight for me. Yes, there was awesome moments that were more nuanced for Kaz. We learned some very revealing
information
that we're going to get into. But I feel like the funnest part of this episode, and I'm hoping we get more of this throughout this season, I love that we are running parallel to the events of The Last Jedi.
Yes.
In fact, it seems like this specific episode might be taking place literally moments after TLJ started.
Yes. Because like when they actually show Dakar, which is where the famous opening scene of Last Jedi starts off with the dreadnought.
Yeah, that was a great start to the movie.
And you get actually the visuals of that are familiar to all of us that watch Last Jedi, especially that destroyed dreadnought. I like that.
Yeah.
That was good. For me.
Did you expect that we would, I know obviously we all knew we would be taking, this show would be going into areas after or post TLJ. I think that was the big excitement at the end of last season. But did you know they would actually be starting off running parallel? Did you expect that?
I wasn't expecting that, because I was really thinking that, especially since how Disney's been kind of like dancing around and trying to actually, you know, not go there, so to speak. They want to play it safe. We've always been questioning about the fact that they don't want to take a risk. They don't want to take a gamble.
They always want to have a condom on, and I just don't understand that. Sometimes condoms are made to be taken off. It's more fun that way.
You feel more natural.
You want the risk.
And you want
that risk that you might get HIV.
And it
heightens
the
pleasure.
It frees your mind.
Yeah, you're like, oh, this is so dirty right now. I might get HIV, but it's okay.
It's okay.
Does anyone else feel like that, or is that just me?
Just
me? Okay. Go ahead, Dave.
But like... finding that out in this episode would be really questionable if it was given to a director that didn't know his pacing.
Right.
And I think that's why this episode was done so well. The directing and the writing was so technically tight.
They worked well together, both Bosco and Brandon.
Yeah, and they knew where to go and not to go. And Bosco basically
Did they know where to go, not to go? Because we don't even... Do we know those lines? Do you think Disney actually says, hey... Because I'm sure from a Comic-Con perspective, a Comic-Con quote, if you were to ask Justin Rich, hey, does Lucasfilm tell you exactly where not to go? He'd be like, no. They give us this. They let us do this. But you got to think that they are. Especially with The Rise of Skywalker. But that's what was really exciting about this episode, Dave, is the potential of this season. Because I saw, when I realized that we're running parallel to The Last Jedi, I realized that doorway for some epic potential just opened up wider. No show, Dave, when you really think about it, no show has had an opportunity like this. Sure, Star Wars Rebels had an opportunity to cross over with Rogue One. In fact, a lot of us had thought it would, right?
Yes.
But we already knew the aftermath or the end result of that entire era. It was all leading up to New Hope. We knew how it was going to end for the most part. Not saying we didn't get some great reveals in Star Wars Rebels, but when it came to that specific crossover, we knew how it was all going to play out.
Yeah.
We are in a completely new territory here. We have no idea. And the awesome thing about this is that for those of us watching live, I hope people are jealous of us in years to come, because for the next 2 months, Dave, we will have a unique perspective that no one will ever be able to experience quite like we are currently.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to predict it.
No, because in 2 months, the big mysteries will be revealed in The Rise of Skywalker,
exactly. The
end of an era. So this whole thing is going to be open territory for the most part, and anyone that decides to watch Resistance, let's say in 6 months or 7 months or a year, they're not going to have that same edgier seat. Oh, this is so fucking fresh. We have no idea what's going to happen.
Yeah. And
we've never been in this territory before. Even with Clone Wars, Dave. Clone Wars was awesome, right?
Oh, yeah.
But we knew it was taking place between Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith. So, yes, there was so much story there. Such a beautiful story that unfolded. But ultimately, we knew the end game. We knew the aftermath. We knew what would happen, where it's all leading. With this, we have no idea.
Exactly. And like the thing that I really liked about this, when you see the nuances of this episode, you appreciate how Bosco was actually able to weave this episode, because like he understood that he had to actually make those ties to Last Jedi, but not take away from Resistance story. This isn't about Last Jedi. This is about Resistance.
See, I'm gonna disagree with you, Dave. I feel like the show Star Wars Resistance is more heavily connected to the Rise of Skywalker than we had been thought.
Rise of Skywalker, yes, but Last Jedi?
Well, can anything be connected to Last Jedi? Last Jedi is like a vignette.
Okay,
It's like a moment. We've never had a movie quite like that. It's just a moment, and then it's over.
And then it's over.
But with us getting closer and closer to The Rise of Skywalker, Dave, this show is titled Star Wars Resistance.
Yes.
Star Wars Rebels was called Star Wars Rebels, but again, we already knew where it was leading. Star Wars Resistance has a very unique
opportunity
to get into areas that we won't be able to get into, possibly even in the movies. And yes, I'm against that. You know, I feel like the main Skywalker story should be told in the movies. And I'm yes, when it comes to Skywalker's story, the Skywalker saga, that should remain in that movie.
Yeah.
But the bigger picture of the Resistance versus the First Order, this is where it should take place. This is where we can delve in to those areas. It's no different than the Clone Wars. Think of it like this. Yes, we had Attack of the Clones. Yes, we had Revenge of the Sith. But the Clone Wars actually dealt with the Clone Wars, whereas we saw maybe a total of 5 minutes in the movies of the actual Clone Wars.
That's a good point.
Same thing here.
Yeah.
The story of the Skywalker saga, Kylo Ren and whatever Rey's connection is, and of course Luke Skywalker and Princess Leia, that story is being told in The Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, and The Rise of Skywalker. But the bigger story of the Resistance versus the First Order,
can
be told here. And so for the briefest of moments, Dave, I feel like the Resistance fans of this show, of the TV show Resistance, will be able to experience a level of mystique that won't be there if you watch later or when it's available to stream.
And I think that's...
I think they're missing out.
I think that's the important part too, is like trying to make Resistance feel important now, because
it feel more important
it
now?
It feels more important now.
Yeah, it does, Dave. Because last year we're like, this is so inconsequential. It just doesn't matter to the bigger story. What are they doing? They're wasting all this potential. And now, with the ending of season one and what the direction they were going leading into season two, suddenly we're like, holy fuck, there's so much potential.
There's potential. And that's the thing, is like it all comes down to now their execution. And
execution, exactly, Dave.
Yeah,
you're
they
right.
have to execute Order 66.
Yes.
But like that's where the only thing that I'm really worried about is like creative decisions. Okay, just like what you said, we don't know. We can't predict where we want.
You're talking about
go.
With the actual characters
with
of the show.
With the actual characters right. of the show.
And we'll get into that in a
and,
second.
And that's where it's kind of dicey for me in this episode. But overall, just going back to what we were saying, this episode was very well done.
Yeah.
It's actually even stronger than a lot of like season one.
Well, dude, I think this is one of the strongest episodes that we've had to date.
To date.
And even after the Rise of Skywalker, let's say that premieres, it's post December. We come back from holiday break. Resistance has an entire second half, Dave, to go. After the Rise of Skywalker premieres, we still have another half of the season to get through. There is so much that they will be able to do. And we're going to get into a bit of that speculation towards the end of the show, because I feel like we need to get into the actual events of this week. But I think before we end, we have to get into the potential post the Rise of Skywalker. All right, so Tam this week, Dave.
Yes.
All eyes are on Tam. What will she do? Will her fears and anger subside? Or will they be fueled by the people around her aboard the First Order crew? That's the question there. And yes, we both have had some opinions on the creative direction of this episode when it comes to Tam.
Yeah.
Because we want her to be bad. Not full-on evil. We want her to be morally compromised.
Yeah, we want her to be morally compromised, and you want us to really understand the First Order's M.O.
Right. Well, Agent Tierney's manipulative approach has paid off up to this point.
Uh-huh.
And now we have Tam sandwiched in between her and Rucklin.
That's the creative decision.
But it might be that devil on your shoulder. Yes, I was a little confused with Rucklin's appearance. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, Dave. Did we actually see Rucklin join the First Order last year?
No, I can't
recall. Are you positive? Did he not? I thought he got on the ship with them at the end. Remember when they're all flying away?
That one? No, I can't remember it. Because I even thought about it. I went back to our past notes. Rucklin is one of those characters that basically me and you have always went
either.
Back and forth about. Is like, what the heck was his point in season one?
I feel like they were trying to work on something with this character, because it seemed like, from a writing perspective, Dave, and if you know what goes on in writing rooms, you have several avenues written down. When you're breaking a story on that whiteboard, you have various different avenues you can go. I'm like, okay, well, if we go here, then this character will work here. This potential storyline will connect here. It'll be a nice, story B to work on.
Yeah.
But if we go this way, we won't need this character, but he'll be here for a later time. And I feel like that was what happened with Rucklin. I feel like they were trying to possibly turn him into a bit of an arch nemesis last year.
Yeah, for Kaz.
For Kaz, exactly. And then they changed direction, which we know this with certainty, with 100% certainty. It's obvious. The show changed direction in the second half, and it became more focused, a lot better, and it seems like Rucklin kind of lost. We lost sight of Rucklin.
Yeah,
and his animosity towards Kaz.
And then the story became more about Kaz and Tam because of their different ideals.
Right. Which I think works better because Tam was a friend. And because Tam was a friend. Hold on a second. You got to talk. I just lost something.
Oh, well, going to like what you were saying is like, because it's a friend for me, the way I saw it is seeing that difference in opinion and ideals between Kaz and Tam, who are both on the same side, it made it so relatable to the audience and made it understandable to the audience that basically you could see this type of debate going on back and forth, and it did. And it had more impact than seeing Kaz go against Jace, who quite honestly, Jace was featured as almost kind of like the stereotypical mustache wheeling douchebag.
Yeah, and I think if they would have gone that direction though, using him as a roadblock, you know,
it just would be...
for Kaz, I think it would have worked. But Tam being the better choice, Justin Ridge and his writers probably looked at everything they had working and brewing, and they said, hey, you know what? What if we did this?
Instead of this.
Instead of going with Ruckley and we go with Tam, it would be more personal. It'd be more intimate because there's a relationship there. Let's tear down that friendship in a way that we've never quite seen before, except, of course, the obvious Anakin and Obi-Wan. Let's do something like that. Let's have a difference. Let's take reality, which, again, Dave, I'm not about putting messages into kids' shows, but we know that today, in today's world, it's very divisive. Everyone's fighting against each other. Everyone's very strong with their political beliefs.
Yes.
And friendships and families are being torn apart because of opposing ideology.
Yeah.
Which is fucking absurd to begin with.
It's because absurd.
No one side is evil in this country.
No.
Okay? Guess what? We grow up on different sides of the world, different sides of the country, and we all are subjected to different things that forms our own personal politics.
And that's what made the relationship between Tam and Kaz so special.
Yes.
Because it's so relatable. And it's not
they're
overblown.
Taking things from reality, from what's going on today. Dude, I mean, that's what broke them apart, Kaz and Tam, is the differencing, the differing political views.
And, like, going back to, like, the choice of Jace, I was really confused about bringing him back because he was so left inconsequential in season one. I mean, you had him as one of the aces, and then all of a sudden he gets reduced to janitorial, to waste management. And I swear to God, it's like, what the heck is up with waste management? Because, like, that seems to be a reoccurring thing in Star Wars in the new era. You have, like, Jace going to waste management, Finn's in waste management. You have Kylo Ren masquerading as a waste management manager. And it's like, why in the world would they actually want to make this character, Jace, the center of all attention when it comes to the opposition, the villains? Because he's not...
Because he's a white male, Dave.
He's not very villainous. He's just very douchey.
You know what? Okay. This is where we might disagree, because setting aside the fact that I was very confused as to him appearing suddenly. Like, hey, I'm here. I'm part of the First Order. Let's get rid of that for a moment. Let's set aside our confusion on how he appeared. I'm okay with this because I think Tam needs some more nudging.
But wouldn't that be for tyranny to do, though?
Yes, but also someone from the Colossus. Someone that also has grievances with Kaz. I feel like it'll be... I don't think it's needed, necessarily. However, if they're going to do it, it can work in a way that will help create conflict within Tam. How many times can we see tyranny manipulate her with words before we start looking at Tam like she's an idiot? Like, do you not see what she's doing? So let's give her a break a bit and use Rucklin, someone from the Colossus, someone who is a part of their group. Let's use him to be that devil on the shoulder just a bit to get her to push her into that area a little more.
I guess you do have a point, because when you think about it,
I don't think it's needed necessarily, but it does work. If they're going to do it, it's not a bad decision.
It's not a bad decision, especially when you take into account that while Rucklin is actually trying to sway Tam through his own means, where he threatens to tell her, if you don't tell so-and-so, I'm going to tell on you.
Yeah.
I'd be like,
Rucklin, weren't you cleaning the toilet last week? Get the fuck out of here.
But then you go to, I guess when you think about it, you look at the parallel now, because it's about a parallel between Tam and Kaz, and you have Kaz who has to deal with Sonara questioning Tam's motives. And Sonara, I think that worked better than Tam and Rucklin. But when you take a when you think about it, you have on the other side Kaz being told by Sonara, you know, you shouldn't trust her, because, and Sonara talks from experience where she goes, I know about not trusting people.
Yeah, because I also betrayed you,
because,
Kaz.
Yeah. And like, I guess you're right. We can't, I always thought Tyranny was going to be that one character that was going to constantly influence Tam. You know, kind of like the whole Darth Sidious on Anakin, where Tyranny is actually going to be Tam's quote-unquote Darth Sidious. But if we're trying to, just like what you said, make this more relatable, make this more believable, you have to show a foil to the other side.
Yeah. I just, and my only issue with Rucklin being there, this is the only thing that makes me afraid, is I'm hoping they're not swapping out Tam for Rucklin.
Where I hope so too. No.
Tam yeah. suddenly becomes the inside man. She becomes the one working with the within the inside for the resistance.
Suddenly
because she
switches.
Realizes that they're evil. I'm like, if you didn't realize they were evil before, you're not gonna suddenly realize it now. I mean, you were so on board, not just with the First Order, but the Empire, because you saw that they did lots of good things from your perspective. So I feel like this season needs to really focus on that. If Tam does end up switching sides, it has to be after she's been morally compromised. And I feel like if they were to go the distance with her, where have her make a decision. Like, they almost did it this week. The fact that she allowed the First Order to open fire on the Colossus and almost destroy them, that was step one. That was step one in her path, in her journey. She did nothing to stop it. Nothing. That right there is a bad decision. She allowed herself to be pushed into making a decision by Rucklin that she knew wasn't necessarily the right call. Morally.
Yes.
Morally putting all those lives in jeopardy. How many people are on the Colossus that aren't Resistance members that were just there because of Kaz and Yeager and Doza's decisions? Those people were innocent.
Yeah.
And Tam was willing to let them be destroyed. I like that, and I want to see more of that, but I want it to go the distance. I want her to make a decision that ends in life, in the end of life, in death, I should say. Jesus.
The thing is,
do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And
do you think
then,
that, do you
then
think that
Dave,
Resistance will go that route, though?
They have to. They have to. And why wouldn't they? Yeah, it's a Disney show, but we're dealing with a show called Star Wars. Like, guess what? People die. And we've seen people die already in this show, right? In explosions. It doesn't need to be graphic and
in
your face.
It doesn't have to be graphic or in your
face.
But
I think if
like
they
this.
Allude to people's death, I think that's a powerful message there.
I mean, one of the most powerful messages we saw in season one was the destruction of Hosian Prime. That's millions of people just dying in a blink of an eye.
Yeah. I don't mind if they have her, I guess, if the writers make her have a change of heart towards the end, when she's made a few bad decisions, like really bad decisions, then she decides to change. But we know as a character, there is no redemption for what you've done, but at least you chose the good side at the end. I'll be happy with that.
That I'd be happy with also, because I don't want her turn happening in the next episode.
No. I don't think they're going to do that. I don't think. Okay, Dave, if they do that, it would be bad writing, because they've been working on this
for a while,
for over a year.
Yeah.
They've been working on this just to do what? To get her on board that ship and then change your mind. She has been pretty passionate about her beliefs.
And you would ruin the whole setup of Agent Tyranny, because honestly, out of all the First Order characters,
she's interesting.
She is the most interesting character.
I agree.
I mean, one moment I find myself actually saying, oh my God, she's a First Order officer. How can you trust her? But then, you know, Tyranny just has this weird sense of charisma where you understand why Tam follows her.
Yeah.
And sees her as a mentor.
Yeah. All right, so let's talk about Kaz. Kaz needs to be a bit smarter.
Well, tell us something we don't know.
It was the only thing that bothered me was that message he sent. That was the only thing that bothered me. And I know he sent it last week, and I was like, all right, well, whatever. But now that it can be tracked, and he was willing to risk the lives of everyone so he can send a message to Tam, someone who already chose her side, it feels a little Jar Jar to me.
No, you know what it feels
like?
Like,
I'm going to make a really bad decision and put everyone's life in jeopardy.
You know what it felt like to me? I agree with you that it feels like Jar Jar, but it, down to its core, it feels like something like a naive child would do. And that's what angers me about the choice of doing this on Kaz.
Well, they go back and forth with him because Kaz is not a child.
Kaz made his decision. He chose to be part of the resistance. He goes against his family. That's all his choice. He is not a child. Don't make him
he's not even an idiot. Not even a teenager. He's in his 20s.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he acts very naive.
Naive.
And I feel like that's a decision he might have made, and justifiably, last year before the second half. But now that all these things are happening and he understands what's at risk here, it seems a little bit out of character, I think. Maybe it doesn't feel out of character, and that's the problem. Maybe at this point he should be a little more hardened. He should understand what's at risk here. So we'll see. I mean, we've been struggling with what the writers have done with him. They've managed to repair a lot of those issues, but this feels like we've taken a few steps back. I'm hoping we move 20 steps forward next episode, and then we'll just forget about this. Kaz's parents are alive.
Especially with that revelation.
Okay, so all I can say is please be bad.
At this point, yes.
Please be bad.
Please be evil.
I feel like that's another creative decision that I just can't, not a bad decision. I don't want to criticize the writing because I feel like the writing was good. But creatively, it feels like they're taking away something that can really be used.
Yes.
For the development of Kaz.
What was the development? It was his motivation at the second.
It was his motivation, Dave. You're actually right. It was his motivation that finally got him where he needed to be, and now it has been removed. And it doesn't seem like the right. I can't imagine Justin Ridge making that decision, and that's why I'm thinking they are bad. We have been debating this since the start of since the premiere episode, Dave. We've been talking about this. Kaz's father has to be part of those senators or one of those senators who's aligned with the First Order. It only makes sense to this story. Why introduce him? Why show the differing ideology between father and son? Well, now they have a perfect path to take that story down. They have it. They built the vehicle. Let's get on it. Let's take us there. That's the only reason why Kaz's parents should be alive.
Yes.
Is so that we can find out that they were bad. Because it seems a bit convenient that they were off planet.
Exactly.
Now,
yes.
For them to be off planet would make sense if they were part of the First Order, because they knew the First Order's plan to destroy the planet.
The planet. Yeah.
Or the system, I should say.
That's what I was like thinking to myself, is like the only way this works now is if you turn his family evil. And I don't mean
evil or just bad. I mean, evil seems pretty
evil, because if you think about it, you were off planet conveniently when the First Order.
Well, I guess you are evil. If you're down with an entire system being destroyed.
Destroy.
Yeah, I guess you are evil.
You gotta be evil.
I'm Dr. Evil.
But like, that's why.
You want him to be like that?
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Kaz, I'm evil.
Will you give your daddy a hug?
Come here.
Come here. Give your daddy a hug.
Give me a hug, Kaz. Give me a hug.
Especially the way his father treats him.
Do you want
him.
To see my mini-me? It's in my pants. Come here, Kaz. Oh, wait. That's his son, huh?
That's his son.
Yeah, I'm not down with the incest.
No. But, like, especially since in that dialogue with his father does seem very tyrannical. I'm sorry. Blaming your son for this whole thing. That's kind of extreme there.
Yeah, he did put a lot on Kaz.
He put a lot on
not,
Kaz.
Not like, hey, Kaz, you're alive. I'm so glad. The galaxy's in war right now. Nah, never mind that.
It's all your fault.
It's all your fault.
It's
fart?
It's all your fart.
Dr. Evil.
It's all your fault. And it's like, at this point, I'm like you. You have to make them evil. You got to.
Evil?
Because it, if they weren't, if they did not go that route, and then they just drop it right here, like, you never see his family again.
Yeah. No.
I'd be like going, no motivation for Kaz. Thank you.
No, this was a narrative breadcrumb. We're definitely going to go there again. And, Dave, I'm going to say with 99.9% certainty, this is going to lead to a much bigger story.
Yes.
And his parents, at least his father, will be revealed that he's part of the First Order.
And that's why...
It only makes sense. It feels like a big misstep for them not to go for that.
And that's why, going back to like what we said at the top of the program, this episode is nice. It's technically savvy. It works.
Yeah.
And Bosco and the writer got everything right.
Yeah, they did good.
The question becomes, is this is the creative decisions that we're calling out, but we don't know where they're going with it.
Yeah. And all of this with combined with Tam, I mean, this episode was good. And it is all leading down a path that could lead us to some amazing character building moments. And that's why I'm excited for this show this season, Dave. I mean, balls to the wall. They have to. This is the second and final season. The only season we're ever going to get of Star Wars Resistance.
Yeah.
It's time to push the pedal to the metal. All right, so Poe Zoo, Dave. Get ready for December's release of Star Wars The Rise of Skywalker with the officially licensed range of co-branded Star Wars Poe Zoo footwear. The collection features sneakers and boots inspired from some of the Star Wars saga's most iconic characters, such as Rey, Finn, and Poe Dameron. Wait, Star Wars saga's most iconic... Star Wars saga's most iconic characters as Rey, such as Rey, Finn, and Poe. What did you think? Like Luke Skywalker, Darth Vader, maybe even Chewbacca.
Hey. When they basically told us that this new era, this is our three main characters.
Yeah. Okay. That's fair.
We gotta ride that horse.
Despite that, look within the podcast description of this episode for details on prices and specials. Click through those links. Purchase the shoes through us. It helps the network grow, and it helps us stay on the air. These shoes are fucking awesome.
Oh, dude. The X-Wing black little Converse that they sell. I want to get those so bad.
I have the Kylo Ren. I had the Kylo Ren shoes, high tops, in the cart for the past month. And I keep looking at them like, I'm going to buy you. I mean, I wonder if Pozu can put together like a layaway plan. You think they can do that? Like a payment plan? All right, so let's get into speculation time and possibilities. We teased this at the top of the show, Dave, about all of the potential that this show has now. After The Rise of Skywalker premieres and the mysteries have been revealed, there's really no place this show can't go, in theory.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say they have... I mean, they've been given the keys to the car post The Rise of Skywalker. As long as they don't disrupt the story and change things, I would imagine Justin Ridge is like, they would say, hey, you know what? This is your final season, Justin Ridge, for Resistance. But Silver Lining, do what the fuck you want, bro.
Especially since you have one of the coolest settings I've ever seen in Star Wars up to date, which is the Colossus.
Right.
You could do so many stories about the Colossus by itself.
Yeah. So, in theory, Dave, I don't think we're going to see anything dealing with a lot of these people until post The Rise of Skywalker. But in theory, we can see Palpatine. We can see Snoke. We can even get some Vader action, some mention of him. And, of course, Kylo Ren.
Yes.
They can use all of it if they are allowed. This show, as I said, has the unique potential to be the most relevant Star Wars show of the last decade. even more relevant than, say, the upcoming Mandalorian series, Dave. It really does.
Yes, it does. Because, like, the Mandalorian deals with the past. And there's not... Yes, you can actually...
There's a lot of story to tell.
There's a lot of story to tell.
But once again, we know where it ends.
Exactly.
We know the aftermath.
We don't know the future. That's the thing.
So this could be a tool, Dave, to truly just flesh out this era in a way that we have not been able to. I mean, that's exciting, right?
My mind is just baffled where they could possibly go.
Okay, so is this something they should do? Do you think?
I think they should.
Do you think Resistance should be the show that delves into these things?
They need to.
Do you want to see Palpatine? And I'm not talking from a fan perspective. I'm talking from a critic, from a reviewer of Star Wars and the stories and knowing everything we have going on with comics, books. You and I are both tapped in. We know everything.
Yes.
Do you feel like they should introduce these big players? Post the Rise of Skywalker, would it safe to do it?
If they do not explain certain aspects of those characters, then yes. Like, say, for example...
Meaning we need to get those explanations in the movies.
Yeah, we got to get those explanations in the movies.
But we can fully flesh out and explore.
Exactly.
Yes.
Like, especially with the biggest question in Rise of Skywalker that has to be on everyone's mind.
Mm-hmm.
How the hell did Palpatine survive?
Well, I'm sure that'll be covered in the movie.
Yeah.
But once we know that mystery...
You can flesh it out.
We can talk about it in Resistance because it's no longer a secret. We're not going to be running the risk of spoiling anything. I mean, same thing with Snoke. We can really get into some Snoke action. Snoke was squandered. We know nothing about him, Dave. And yes, I'm sure we're going to learn his purpose in this next movie. We're going to learn why he was there, who he was. Yes, for sure. But we could actually see Snoke in Star Wars Resistance.
And I think that would
help. Because remember, we're running parallel right now.
Yeah, and that would help the character and kind of remove that bad taste from fans' mouths.
Yeah.
Of like, well, he meant nothing.
Right.
He was just a flash in the pan. Great.
Yeah. All right, Dave, so final thoughts then.
Final thoughts on this episode. We've said this once in the show already, but quite honestly, this is... probably one of the best technical episodes to date for Resistance.
Dude, and even the sound design, right?
The sound design was great. It was
so good.
Everything, every single choice that they made was on fire. It was good. You got us excited about Resistance. This is something that you should have done in season one.
What?
Get us excited. Tell us your story. Because that's the number one thing. Don't just focus on, you know, trying to tell the Skywalker story. Tell us your own story. Tell us the story about, you know, like Kaz and Tam. That's fantastic. Tell us about the First Order versus the Resistance. Fantastic. You can make those nods to the movies and still tell a very solid narrative. And they started off in two episodes. They gave us hope that basically this season's going to turn out really good. The only thing that basically I take away from this is basically the creative choices, but I can't take away scores for creative choices because...
No.
You know...
Because you're not writing it.
I'm not writing
it. Now, if those creative choices end up undermining the great potential and it starts affecting the technical side of things, then absolutely you can.
Like,
but as of right now, I don't think it would be fair to.
Yeah, and that's why... On a Rain Man score, I give this an 89.
What?
Yeah, close to a 90. Because
Jesus,
technically,
Dave, you are just giving out those percentages this week.
Directing-wise, Bosco did a fantastic job. Writing-wise, very good. Technically tight. Didn't wander off like they did in season one.
Well,
you actually wrote a viable script.
Well, even the silly side of things, like there was obviously this is a kid show and there's some silly moments, but even that was focused. It was done at the appropriate times.
Yes.
It didn't distract from the story. And again, that was the problem with much of the first half of the first season.
Yeah.
You would completely derail any story you had with the lunacy of some of these characters. And you're just like, what the fuck are you doing? But now this episode here is a perfect example of how to do it, how to keep that silliness there, how to entertain the kids, but also focus on your story.
Focus on your story and basically make it understandable for that character. Because honestly,
makes sense.
Yeah. We may question Kaz's decisions in this episode, but here's the thing. He's a naive character.
It does make sense.
It makes sense. I don't like that decision.
And I wanted them to take a few steps forward with his maturity, but what we've seen of Kaz,
this is who he is.
Right. I'm just hoping they eventually get rid of that. I want him to become Rambo by the end. Just like
that would just be such a weird story arc. Is like suddenly he's this hardened.
Yeah, he like has a tank top warrior. And some tattoos. And he's like Arnold. He's like, get down.
Hey, it was rough seeing Ezra change.
Get to the live speeder.
it was rough seeing Ezra change that, but it made it believable in Rebels. I don't know what you could possibly do to change Kaz.
I'm Kaz. That's a terrible Arnold impersonation. Please strike that from the record and never bring it up again. All right. Well, Dave, this does conclude our discussion. Oh, wait, I didn't give it
yeah,
up.
Yeah, you didn't give your...
Oh,
your,
well, hold on a second. I wanted to quickly sign off after that shameful impersonation. I was trying to run away. I don't know if I'll give it an 89%. I give it a 75. There's a lot of great things in motion. It makes me excited. The potential is there. I felt like this is one of the best written scripts we have received from this writing crew. Specifically, Brandon Allman. We have not been the biggest fan of Brandon Allman.
Nope.
And he did a great job, was very focused. And it was definitely a bit of a window that we can look out and see the potential of things to come. So, strong episode.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it. All right, so patreon.com/remandigitalpledge. That's right. 3 days a week of Back to Tank. Get more Star Wars from the Back to Tank every month when you subscribe to our Patreon page. When you subscribe to our podcast tier for $5. We have a $3 tier option right now. It's only for a limited time. I don't know how long it'll be available, but it's $3 a month currently. And you receive only Star Wars content.
And come on, $3 is Starbucks.
It really is. $3 a month and you gain access to all of our past library of Star Wars shows that we've done, including our weekly Friday show. Because we are doing Mondays, we're doing Wednesdays that are free, and then Fridays will be our Patreon exclusive day. So head over to patreon.com/RaymanDigital and pledge $3 and get some of that Star Wars action. We need help. We push out about 40 to 90 podcast episodes a month as a network. And the only way we can sustain is by getting people to subscribe. So head over, patreon.com/RaymanDigital, and pledge. Thank you, David.
Thank you. May the Force be with us.
Oh, I don't have any music to end the show on.
Listeners, you're our only hope.